called indeed.com, like which is a job portal, like similar to Monster, Naukri and so on. So let's say working on Java, you can see how the job trend had been for the last few years. Similarly, the job trend for COBOL, the job trend for Hadoop. So if you see the job trend for Hadoop, it's increasing in a exponential fashion. Okay. So if you see the job trend for COBOL, it's going down. Similarly, if you see the job trend for Java, right, it's more or less flat, and then lately it had been going down. Okay. So whatever technology you can work, you're working on, so you can go to indeed.com/job trends. Okay. And then you can figure out how the trend had been for the last few years around the technology you had been working on. Okay. So as I said, right, like the main thing is like the certifications, they will help you to increase the probability of getting yourself into a job actually. Okay. It doesn't guarantee a job, but it will definitely help you. Okay. So these are the few companies which do conduct certifications: Databricks, Hortonworks, Cloudera, DataStax. So from Microsoft, like we have .NET certification. So similarly from Oracle, we do have Java certification and so on, right? So along the same lines, okay, so like from Databricks, there's a certification around Spark, okay? And from DataStax, there is a certification around Cassandra, okay? And similarly from Cloudera, they have got a developer certification, an admin certification, okay, and HBase, and finally they have got a data science certification. Okay, so these are the four certifications. And from Hortonworks, there is a developer certification, admin. Okay, so these are the few of the certifications. Okay, like mainly, right, like we'll be focusing on the developer aspect. So okay, so at the end of the training, like you need to spend a little bit more time doing the practice and so on, and then like you will be able to get through the developer certification. Okay, so the more certifications you get through, the more the probability that like you will be shortlisted for the job. Okay, because like many, right, like they do fake the experience, but it's difficult to fake a certification actually. Okay, so certification will tell us that the potential candidate has crossed the minimum threshold. Okay, so it's better to get through as many certifications as possible. Okay, so most of the certification except the data science certification are multiple choice. Okay, multiple choice. Okay, so the data science is a bit tricky, like it's like an architect actually, like when you think about .NET, Java, right? So we have an architect, right? So the data science, I can say it's very similar to an architect role. Okay, so rest of them are mainly multiple choice questionnaires. Okay. So let's see why we need big data. Okay, so most of us, right, like we do spend time on Flipkart, Amazon, eBay. Okay, so what we see is like we see recommendations actually. Okay, so how do you think the recommendations work? Anyone? How do you think the recommendations work? Anyone? How do you think it works? Simply raise your hand. I will ask you. Okay. Yeah. How do you think it works? One of you say analytics, but like analytics is a very vague term actually. Okay. So there should be something specific, right? So yeah, Pankaj, tell me. Yeah.
Yeah, recommendation give you the idea if you want to buy that product or not. If you are talking about particularly Flipkart or something like that, okay. Give you the kind of a choice.
So, yeah, I'm asking how does it work? Like how does a recommendation engine know that I like a big data book and I don't like a COBOL book? How do they know?
There must be algorithm.
That's what algorithm, like what's the rationale behind it? That's what, like everything, most of the things are driven by algorithms, right? Like what? That's what I mean. Okay. Anyone else? Yeah. Okay. So, Praveen, tell me. Yeah. How do you think the recommendations
work? Yeah, it's basically the recommendation works like how you visit. If you visit a frequent Amazon and if you visit some site with having the, you are looking for some products, or then okay. They will take your activities and they will give you recommendation based on your activities.
Your activity, number of visits, right? Like if I look at a book on Java book like 10 times, right? They know that my interest is more on Java, less on COBOL book, right? So based on the activity. So similarly, they do maintain cookies,
Yeah.
cookies, previous purchases. Okay, so these are the few ways. Okay, so let me discuss about one way. Okay, so here, right, like one second. So let's say there are three users and the users bought some books. Okay, do you guys see any pattern in it? Anyone? Okay, so once you are done, right, you can simply unraise your hand. So like in the class, right, like we don't keep our hand raised all the time, right? So once you are done, okay, and like you can unraise. Like, do you guys see any pattern here? Okay, by which I can make some recommendations. Yeah, Pankaj, tell me. Okay. Yeah, Pankaj, tell me.
No, actually, I wrongly raised my hand. I'm sorry.
So once you are done, right, you can simply, okay. Anyone, do you guys see any pattern in it? Anything which we can use it for recommendations? There's some pattern, yeah. What do you think is the pattern? Yes, Praveen, tell me. Hello, Praveen?
Yeah, basically, if you say it's a B1, B2, B3, and B1, B3 is common for two users.
Okay, so what do you say? Like, I can say that these both these users have similar taste, actually. Okay, so like here, right? Like this user, right? Like B1, B2 bought. Sorry, user one bought book one and book two, and similarly, user two has bought book one and book three. Okay. Okay, so I can say they do have similar taste, actually. So what can I do? I can recommend book 4 to user 1, and similarly I can recommend book 3 to user 2. Okay, so this is called collaborative filtering. Okay, it's a type of machine learning algorithm. Okay, so there are a lot of machine learning algorithms. Collaborative filter is one of it. Okay, so this is one way we can do the recommendations. Okay, so first we need to find out similar users and then recommend the books. Okay, so here, right, like we do have only three users, and then they bought some 6-7 books. So we were able to visualize the data, and then like we were able to infer some results out of it. Okay, but if you take the case of Amazon, they do have thousands of users, eBay thousands of users, and then like each one of them might have bought like tens of items. Okay, so we won't be able to visualize the data. Okay, so then we need to use some of the tools and technologies like big data and so on. Okay. So in this case, right, like this entire thing is called raw data. Okay, raw data. So do you think raw data as is useful? Yes or no? Just type it in the chat window. Do you think it is useful, raw data as is? Do you think it's useful? No, right? Raw data, it's all about users buying some books. What will I do? I need to extract some information out of it. So this useful thing is called information. Okay. So the big data tools, right, what it will help you is, it will help you to store the raw data, and it will also help you to convert the raw data into some useful information. Okay. So once we convert this into useful information, what we can do is we can take an action. The action in this case is recommendations, proper recommendations. So what will happen if I make proper recommendations? The customer will buy the book, and then basically it will increase the profits or the bottom line of the company. Okay, so that's the basic gist of big data at a very, very high level. Okay, so let me put it in a different way. Okay, so here we have the raw data from various sources. Okay, like maybe a Twitter, Facebook or something. Okay, raw data is very, very huge. That's the reason why I have put a big square around here. Hadoop or the big data tools, they will help you to store huge amounts of raw data, and they will also help you to process the huge amounts of raw data to convert into some useful information. So we can use some of the machine learning algorithms like classification, clustering, recommendation, or I can do some basic analytics. Analytics means I want to say some reporting. Okay, once it is converted into some useful information, we need to take an action. Okay, in the previous case it was recommendation. And then basically it will increase the bottom line, or it will increase the profits of the company. Okay, so these are the two aspects of big data: store huge amounts of data and process huge amounts of data. Okay. So I see one hand raised. Yes, Sarika, tell me.
So Praveen, I had a question here. My question was, what was being used before the whole big data technologies came into picture, and how is it helpful to use these new technologies against what was already existent before this came?
Okay, so like earlier, right, like there were a lot of tools, like if you take the case of storing the data, right, like there were relational database, okay, but if you see the relational databases, right, so they have been designed like 15, 20 years back, okay. At that time, right, like we didn't have any 2G connection, 3G connection and so on, right? We didn't have smartphones. So keeping the size of the data into consideration, the relational databases have been designed actually, okay? But if you see now 3G, 4G, Facebook, Twitter, okay, not only like there are different ways of generating the data, but there are different data types also, okay? So the relational databases, like which have been designed like 15, 20 years back, right, like they won't be able to meet the current rate at which we are generating the data and the rate at which we want to process the data. Okay, so that's the reason why, like, we do have the big data tools and technologies. Okay, so people are migrating so that they can store, process, analyze huge amounts of data. Okay, so as I said, right, like earlier also we were storing the data, we were processing the data, but the scale was less. But the big data will help you to do at a very large scale, actually. Okay.
And probably so at faster processing speeds also, I guess.
Yes, faster.
To...
Yes, mm-hmm. I'll be talking about it. Like, okay, it's at scale. When I say scale, right, okay. Like it's both storage, processing speed, and so on. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah. Yes, Pankaj. Pankaj?
Yes, so you mean to say it will be the relational database will be replaced by this one and it will be used for transactional database?
I will talk about it a little bit later, but
right.
Most of the systems are moving from the legacy systems, either it be a relational database or either it be a Java system, right? So most of the systems are moving to the big data systems so that they can store and process huge amounts of data. Okay. Yeah. So I'll talk about like in the coming slides how it can store and process huge amounts of data. So as I said, right, like once you are done, right, so you can simply unraise your hand so that I know who are done and who are pending. Okay. Yeah, Chetan, tell me.
Hey, Praveen.
Yes, Chetan, tell me.
Hey, sorry, I just wanted to check like I am audible or not because
yes, you are.
During introduction time I was not able to hear. So my name is Chetan. Actually, I have experience around 9 years, and I'm working in Java J2E. So
okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay. So as I said, right, like once you are done, you can simply unraise your hand so that I know who are all done. Like, okay, Chetan, you can unraise it. Okay. Yeah. Press the same button, you will be done. Okay. So here, right, like as I said, like it's all about storing huge amounts of data, like. Before also we used to store, but like now the scale is a bit more. Okay, I will talk about how big data can store huge amounts of data, how it can process huge amounts of data and so on. Okay, I'll be talking about that in the coming few slides. Okay. So when we talk about big data, right, there are three dimensions. One is variety, velocity and volume. Okay, so they call it 3V. Now they moved it to 4V. These are the like four dimensions, I'll be talking about them. So first let's talk about the volume. Okay, so this graph, right, like or this diagram, I got it from the NASSCOM report. Okay, so in 2005 it costed around $19 to store a gigabyte of data. So in 2015, last year, it costed around like less than $1 to store a gigabyte of data. Okay, so that's the reason why the companies are storing more and more data. Okay, because of the hardware cost is going down, and also because of the tools like, okay, sorry, yeah, now you should be seeing it. Okay, as I said, there are three dimensions of big data. One, okay, now you should be seeing it. It's called variety, velocity, volume. Okay, so I'm explaining, like initially it was 3V, now they talk about 4V. Okay, so let me talk about these four dimensions. Okay, one second. Okay. So I was saying, like, in 2005, right, it costed around $19 to store a gigabyte of data, and last year it costed around less than $1 to store a gigabyte of data. The storage costs are going down day by day. Okay, so that's the reason why the companies, right, they are storing more and more data. Okay, also because of the tools like Hadoop and so on, they are storing more and more data each year. Okay, so this is again from the NASSCOM report. So they say the companies are storing 41% more than the previous year. Okay, so let's say last year they stored 100 gigabytes of data. Okay, this year they will be storing 141 gigabytes of data, and next year they will be storing another 41% on top of it. Okay, so it's like a compound interest. They call it compound annual growth rate. Year by year they are storing 41% more data. Okay, because of two reasons: because of the hardware cost going down, and also because of the softwares like Hadoop and the different big data tools and technologies. Okay, the second aspect of big data, it's called variety. Okay, so if you take the case of relational database, it's all about textual data and some relationships. Okay, relationships. Okay, but you can store a audio, video, right, as a blob, binary large object. But relational databases are mainly for textual data and relationships among them. Okay, so I can have a customer data, sales data, join them too. But if you take the case of big data, so you can store any type of data. Okay, so like you can store a audio. What will I do with an audio? Maybe I will compress it. Okay, or I will extract the text out of it. Okay, similarly, I can store a video in big data tools and technologies. Maybe then I can compress it. Okay, or right, I can do any binary data processing. Okay, so it doesn't make sense, but I can store corrupted data also in big data. Okay, it doesn't make sense. Okay, just to make my point, we can store any type of data. So recently I had been to a big data seminar. What they were doing is, like, they were doing some analysis on the human DNA and the rat DNA. Okay. Okay, so just to give an example, I'm no expert in DNA and all those things, but they were talking about this particular concept where they use the big data to do the analysis of this. Okay. And the third dimension of big data, it's called velocity. Okay, so let's say the same credit card, it's being swiped in two different locations. Okay, let's say in New York and New Delhi at the same time. What does it mean? Just quickly type in the chat window. What does it mean? Two credit cards at the same time. What does it mean? It means there's a good probability that there's a fraud happening. Okay. So what will the credit card do? They have to mitigate it, actually. Okay. So they have to either cancel the credit card or they have to cancel the transaction. Okay. So the sooner they detect the fraud, the sooner they can mitigate it. Okay, so let's say they identify the fraud after a day or two. Okay, so there's a good chance that more and more fraud will happen. Okay, the fraudster will buy more and more items. Okay, so they have to identify the fraud as soon as possible. Okay, so that's the velocity aspect. Okay, the big data tools and technologies, they can process the data at a very fast pace, as one of you said. Okay, so not only in the case of fraud detection, similarly in the case of e-promotions, in the case of recommendations. So let's say we go to Amazon.com and the recommendations should happen instantaneously. It's not like the recommendations will be shown after a minute or two. Okay. Similarly, in the case of healthcare monitoring, let's say someone is sick and the different metrics are being monitored, like the pulse rate, heartbeat, temperature, and so on. Right? So they're also, like, we might use some of the big data tools and technologies to monitor any anomalies, actually. Okay. So this is the third dimension. Okay. So we talked about variety, velocity, and volume. Okay. And the fourth dimension, it's called veracity. Okay. I don't have any slide around it. Veracity. V-E-R-A-S-I-T-Y. So when we talk about big data, right, so we are talking about huge amounts of data, so there can be a lot of problems. So the data might be coming late, So the data might be incomplete. Okay, so the data might be inconsistent. So like these are the veracity aspects of big data. The big data tools and technologies should be able to handle some aspects of it. Okay, veracity, whether when the data is coming late, the data is incomplete, it should be able to handle in a graceful way. Okay, similarly sometimes the data might be inconsistent. Okay, so these are the four dimensions of big data. Okay, variety, velocity, volume and veracity. Okay. Any questions till now? Okay, so these are the common use cases of big data. Like we talked about recommendations, as in the case of Amazon. Okay, recommendations, right? Like I can apply it for insurance, healthcare, manufacturing, right? Like we can apply it for different domains. Okay, so that's the reason why I said these are the general use cases. Similarly, fraud detection, insurance, there can be some fraudulent claims. Okay, similarly, retail, right? There can be some theft. Okay, so we can use it for different domains. Okay, similarly, like we can use it for customer segmentation. I'll be talking about it in the coming few slides. Network intrusion, reporting, sentiment analysis. Okay, so I'll be talking about them in the next few slides. Okay, so these are the common use cases which are applied to different domains. Okay, it's not limited to a few domains. Okay, wherever we have huge amounts of data, like we can apply the big data tools and technologies. Okay, so if you want to know some of the common use cases around big data, so there is a site called Big Data Made Simple. So here they talk less about technology, more about how big data is being used in retail, manufacturing, whatever domain you are in, right? So if you see a role of big data in the banking, right? If you are from a banking sector, like you can just read through the article. Okay, similarly, big data, right? Like it's being used in retailer. Okay, so interview with Eric around MasterCard. Okay, so here you can click on this particular URL and then you can see all the articles around banking and finance, similarly how it is being used in marketing and so on. Okay, so let me send this URL. As I said, it's less of technology, more about how big data is being used in this particular domain. Okay, so this is updated very regularly. Okay, so what I'm doing is, like whenever I show you some interesting URLs, I would be typing them in the chat window. Okay, so you can save them or whatever you want to. Okay, Big Data Made Simple. Okay, it's a very interesting site. Okay, so back to my presentation. So the big data tools, right? Like not only like we can see what happened in the past. Okay, so we can generate some reports, dashboards, right? Okay, what happened, why it happened. So we can also see what is currently happening. Okay, what is currently happening? It's called real-time analytics. Okay, we can also predict the future also. Okay, so when we predict the future, right? So we do predict with a bit of probability. Okay, so when I say tomorrow it will snow like 1 inch, 2 inch, okay, what do we do? We do with a bit of probability. We say tomorrow it might snow or it might rain with 75% probability. Okay, so why do we need to predict the future? Anyone? Why do we need to? Just type it in the chat window. Why do we need to predict the future? Like one of you said, to take precautions. Okay, to put it in a different way, so that we are prepared actually. Okay, so let's say tomorrow it rains, what will I do? I'll carry my umbrella, right? So tomorrow if it snows, right, so like I'll wear a jacket. So it's all about preparing ourselves. Okay, so big data tools, not only we can look into the past, what happened, why, what is happening currently, as in the case of fraud detection, sales and so on, we can try to predict the future also. Okay, so that we are prepared, we can make some decisions and so on. Okay, so let's say how we can use the big data tools and technologies. So let's say I am into real estate. Okay, I do sell houses. Okay, so let's say I do plot a graph, a scatter graph or a scatter plot. So here I do have the number of years, sorry, year. And on the y-axis, I do have the number of houses sold. So here what we can do is we can try to fit a curve. Okay, so there are three curves. Okay, so I can fit a curve like this. Okay, so I can try to fit a curve. One second. I can fit a curve like this. I can fit a curve like this. Okay, or another curve like this. Okay, so which do you think is the best fit curve? 1, 2, 3. Just type it in the chat window. Which do you think is the best fit curve? 2, right? Like, because if you see the curve 1, 3 points fall on one side. If you see the curve 3, again 3 points fall on one side. So I say 2 is the best fit curve. Okay, so we'll try to fit a best fit curve, and then what we can do is we can extend it, or we can extrapolate the curve. Okay, so I can extend the curve or extrapolate. Okay, so this is how we do the predictions actually. So, okay, so I can say in 2017, okay, so I will be able to sell these many number of houses, and similarly in 2018 I will be able to sell these many number of houses. Okay, so this is called regression. Okay, okay, so like when we try to fit a curve, it's called non-linear, and similarly when we try to fit a line, it's called linear regression. Okay, so like this is what it's called regression. Okay, so here, right, like we have year and the number of houses sold. Okay, so the number of houses sold, right, it's not simply dependent on the year. There are a lot of other factors like the GDP, okay, and similarly the employment rate, okay, the maybe the average salary. Okay, so I can add lot of features. Okay, lot of features. Okay, so here, right, like when we have similarly large amount of data, right, so again we can use the big data tools and technologies to do the regression, and then we can try to predict the future actually. Okay, so here, right, like I know in 2018 I'll be able to buy these many houses. So what will I do? Like I'll be prepared myself. I'll buy a bigger office. I will hire more employees, right? So basically I will prepare myself. Okay, so this is how we try to predict the future actually. Okay, so one of the question is, can you explain linear versus non-linear? So here, if I try to fit a curve, it's called non-linear regression. If I try to fit a line or a plane, it's called linear regression. Okay, so I won't be talking about this in this course, like, but when you take the analytics course, so they'll be talking about this in a bit more detail. Okay, but just I wanted to show you how we can predict the future. Okay, yeah, okay. So let's talk about few more use cases. Okay, so here, right, like the big data, right, like it is being used for customer segmentation and targeted advertising. Okay, so as in the case of Walmart, okay, eBay and so on. Okay, so let's say this is the age of the customer and this is the salary of the customer or the spending habit or anything. Okay, so here you see there are three segments of customers. Okay, I can call this as segment 1, segment 2, segment 3. Okay, so that's what the different retailers do actually. Okay, they segment the customers and then they, one second. Yeah, professor, tell me. Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, tell me. Yeah.
Hello. I'm sending some of the queries, so please look at
the No, like it's a, there's no question, right? Like if there's a question, I will definitely address that. Like if you, I, you say, I think it is called regression curve, what will I do with it? If there's any query, definitely I will respond back. If there's no query, right, there's nothing to respond back, right? Yeah. Also, right, like as I said, like I won't be entertaining much over the chat window. Like if you have any queries, so simply you can raise your hand, okay? So you say X and Y are equally in relay regression, what will I do with it then? Right? So let's try to get with the flow, okay? Yeah. So here, right, like these are the three segments of customers, okay? So what we can do, we can target them individually. So what I can do is, like I can send an email to them, okay? Or we can send some coupons to them, or I can invite them to a conference, okay? So first what they do is, like they segment them into different groups, and then they do some targeted advertising, okay? So here we have very small data, and then we have two dimensions, okay? So we were able to visualize it and then identify the segments, okay? But there are a lot of others also. There can be one of the feature or one of the dimension can be spending habit, okay? So one of the dimension can be location. Then gender. Okay, so here we might have lot of dimensions and we have lot of data. Okay, so then again here we use some of the big data tools and technologies for customer segmentation and targeted advertising. Okay. Okay. Any questions on this? This is another use case of big data. Okay. Similarly, like big data tools are used for classification actually, okay? So classify, okay, so let me talk about this a little bit. Okay, classify, if you take the case of Gmail, okay, so email is classified as spam, non-spam, okay? Can you guys tell me a few more examples of classification? Just type it in the chat window, yeah. Any other examples of classification? Inbox, okay, bulk important, okay. So let's say there is a customer, a bank customer. Okay, I can classify him as a potential customer and non-potential customer. Okay, and what else? Any other classification? Let's say there is a transaction. Okay, what can I classify it as? A fraudulent transaction or a genuine transaction? Okay, what else? Okay, so these are the few examples of classification. Okay, so let's take the case of Gmail. Okay, so how do you think it works? Okay, so there's no person or an individual who will classify the Gmail or email as spam and non-spam. It should be automatic. How do you think it works? Anyone? Just raise your hand. Like I want to make it a conversation, okay? So that's the reason why I'm asking you, okay? I can continuously talk for 3 hours. How do you think it works? Yeah, Praveen, tell me.
So basically, if mail having some images and some advertisement kind of thing, then it will consider as a spam. Okay. And with having a two proper email addresses in two, or from, okay, then they will classify as a non-spam email.
So like you say, like we need to have a rule engine, right? Like rules, right, actually. Yeah. I need to say if this then that, if this then that, right? So the thing is, like the spammers, right, like they're smart enough. So what they will do is, like they will say in the subject, right, so instead of saying get rich, okay, they will say get richy. Okay, so they will try to cheat the system. They will try to cheat the rules engine actually, okay? So they're smart enough, okay? So there should be more of an automated way of like identifying spam and non-spam, okay? So let me talk about how Google does this, okay? So what they do have is, they do have a corpus. A corpus is a collection, okay? A collection of spam email and then they do have a corpus of non-spam email. Okay, it's like a collection. Like whenever I get a spam email, right, I simply click on spam, it will be added to the spam corpus. Okay, so what happens is this spam and non-spam corpus, okay, so it is fed to a machine learning algorithm. Okay, and the machine learning algorithm, what it will do is it will try to find some patterns. Okay, so like if you show me a fruit, right, what will I do? If the fruit is soft, if the fruit smells, okay, that's a pattern. I will say that the fruit is rotten, it's not fresh. Okay, similarly the machine learning algorithm, it will try to find patterns automatically. Okay, like if it's a word, rich, okay, or get thin, right? So it's all, these are all the patterns. Okay, so the ML algorithm, there are a lot of ML algorithms, they can find the patterns. Okay, so when a new email comes, okay, the new email is fed to the pattern, and the pattern will automatically classify the email as spam or non-spam. Okay, so this pattern, like it's a layman term, like they call it as a model. Okay, so like when you say to a machine learning expert a model, they will understand it. Okay, but like to keep it easy, I say pattern. Okay, so here they use the big data tools in two ways actually. Okay, so one is, what does it make sense, like if I have a corpus of one email or a corpus of 1 billion email, similarly a corpus of one spam email, or what does it make sense? Just type it in the chat window. Yeah, which makes sense, big corpus or a small corpus? The big corpus, right? Like the bigger the corpus is or bigger the collection is, more they accurate the pattern. Okay, so here to identify the patterns, we use the big data tools and technologies so that they can identify the pattern. Okay, similarly the other use cases, whenever a new email comes, right, it should be classified as spam and non-spam. Okay, so here also we use some of the big data tools and technologies. Okay, because like if you take the case of Gmail, right, like there are a lot of accounts, and then like we do get a lot of emails in each account, right, so they use some of the big data tools and technologies. Okay, so again, like when you take the analytics course, they will talk about what is classification algorithm, like what are models, there are like couple of machine learning algorithms for classification. Okay, this is how they do it. Okay, they don't have a set of rules engine because it's difficult to maintain a rules engine. Okay, the spammers, they do get smart and they try to get around the rules engine. Okay, this makes sense, right? Similarly, any questions around this, how Google does identify spam, non-spam? Okay, so similarly, right, like again, there was a competition held by Google, and one of the girl, right, like she got a prize in the competition. Okay, so what she did was, like when you think about cancer, there are two types of cancer, they call it benign cancer, non-benign cancer. Okay, it is like good cancer. Okay, so she collected lot of good cancer reports. Okay, and lot of bad cancer reports. Okay, and she fed all these to a machine learning algorithm. It's called artificial neural networks. Okay, so they try to mimic the brain neurons. Okay, and it identify the patterns. Okay, so let's say there's a big lump, or there's some texture in a report, right? Like it identifies that's a good, bad cancer or a good cancer. Okay, so then whenever we get a new cancer report, okay, so it will automatically classify as a good cancer or a bad cancer. Okay, it will do it with some probability, some percentage of probability, saying that okay, 50% it's good, 50% it's bad, or when it is confident, it will do with more probability. Okay, so it's called level of confidence or probability. Similarly, I can apply the same thing for customer also. Okay, potential customer, non-potential customer. Potential that he will buy a product for me. Non-potential, it means that he won't buy a product for me. Okay, so this is another use case of big data. Okay. We already talked about fraud detection. Like recently, I'd been to a big data conference. Companies like American Express, MasterCard, okay, so they use some of the big data tools and technologies to identify the frauds actually. Because if you take the case of Visa, MasterCard, right? So there are a lot of cards and then there are a lot of transactions actually. Okay. So like day by day, right? Like the like one of you asked me, okay, what is new? The thing is like day by day the number of credit cards are increasing, the number of transactions are increasing, the number of people who are purchasing on the commerce site, e-commerce site are increasing. Okay, so the existing tools and technologies they can process, but it will take days and days together. Okay, but with the big data tools and technologies, we will be able to process it faster, large scale, right? It's all about scale, time, and so on. So these are the few of the use cases around big data. Okay, as I said, just go through the big data made simple site and then like you can dig through whatever you are interested, right? Finance, healthcare, retail, okay? So you can dig through in a bit more detail, okay? So, 1 second. Okay. So how many of you have gone through the LMS? Okay, so this is the LMS. Okay, it's built on Moodle. Okay, so this session recording, okay, so basically they have to do some processing and so on. It won't be done immediately, but after a couple of hours, like you can go through the LMS and then you can see the recording here. Okay, similarly, there will be some assignments, like I have uploaded some comics, some reading material and so on. Okay, so I'll be going through some of them. Okay, so whatever commands I would be using, right, so like I'll be uploading the commands here. Okay, so like almost everything, okay, videos, assignments, project work, everything is done in the LMS. Even the whiteboard which I'm scribbling, right, so this whiteboard I'll be converting into the PDF and then I'll be uploading the PDF also. Okay, so it won't be like a immediately, but it will take some time to do the conversion and so on. Okay, so let's slowly jump into the technical aspect. Okay, so how many of you heard about Apache? Just raise your hand. Apache. Yeah. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, 6, 7. Maybe like very few have heard about Apache. Okay. So Apache, right? Like, or Apache Software Foundation. Okay. So it's a non-profit organization. Okay. It's a non-profit organization. Under the Apache Software Foundation, there are a lot of projects. Okay. There are a lot of projects like Hadoop, Hive, Pig, and so on. The good thing or the important thing about the Apache Software Foundation is there are a lot of projects. All the projects are open source actually. So what I mean by open source is you can see the code. Okay. So can we see the code for Windows? No. Can I see the code for MS Office? No. Right. But here, all the projects under the Apache Software Foundation, I can see the code. Okay. So I can download the code, I can improve it, I can change it, I can modify it as per my requirement. I can do whatever I want to. Okay. It's all open source. So let me show you the code under the Apache Software Foundation. One second. Okay. So this is the link. I'm sharing the link. Okay, so here, like, we do have the different projects. Okay, so here if you see, if you search for Hadoop, right? So Hadoop is there. Similarly, Pig is there. Hive is there, right? Hive is a project. Okay, HSpace is a project. Okay, so there are a lot of projects. So let me show you the code for Hadoop. Okay, I shared this URL. You can check it out later. Okay? Hadoop. I can see the code. It's a bit deep nested folder structure, but like that's the way it is. So here if you see, like, there are a lot of Java files. Okay, so that's what I meant by open source actually. Okay, so I can download the code. There are some tools for downloading the code. So once I download the code, I can modify it as per my requirement. I can change it. I can make it faster. I can fix some bugs. Okay, so I can do whatever I want to. Okay, so that's what I meant by open source. Okay, few of you might are from mainframes. Mainframes, it's mainly proprietary, but like if you take the case of big data software, 99.9% of them are open source. Okay, you can download the code, you can play with it the way you want to. Okay, yes, Santosh. Hello. You have to unmute and talk to me here. Yeah. Hello. Okay. Yes, Raja, tell me.
Praveen. Yeah, I just wanted to understand what is the scope of big data when we are talking about machine learning or IoT.
Okay. Let's stick to the context. Okay, I will take it later then. Okay, I'm talking about, like, I don't want to. That's one of the thing I do. Like, I tend to stick to the context. Okay, so later on you might ask about it. Otherwise, right, like, we'll be going in all directions. At the end of the day, right, like, we won't be completing anything. Okay, so let's stick to the context. Okay, yeah. Bridge, tell me. Yeah. Hello. Bridge, I see your hand raised.
Sorry, I'll unraise my hand. Sorry. No, my hand was...
Okay, no problem. Yeah. Anyone else? So basically, Apache Software Foundation is a non-profit organization where we do see a lot of projects. It's all open source, actually. Okay. So what can happen is, like, individual like me, okay, so I can get the code from the Apache Software Foundation. Okay, so make some improvements and then push it back to the Apache Software Foundation. Similarly, one of you can get the code from the Apache Software Foundation and make some improvements and then push it back. Okay, similarly, company like Microsoft, okay, again, they can get the code, improve it and push it back. Similarly, Cloudera, they can get the code, improve it, and then push it back. Okay. So, like here, right, like what happens is, any code which Microsoft makes, it will be got by Cloudera. Okay. So similarly, any code changes I make or you make, I will be getting it. Okay. So here, right, like what happens is, the different companies and different individuals are working in a collaborative fashion. Okay, so if you take the case of big data, right, it's very huge, and one company, they can't, like, make or improve. Okay, so that's the reason why all the different companies and individuals, they work in a collaborative fashion through the Apache Software Foundation. Okay, so what can happen is, there can be an individual, XYZ, who can introduce some bugs in the code. Okay, so that's the reason why they do have a set of guidelines, checkpoints, and so on, so that bugs are not introduced in the code. Okay, deliberately someone can introduce it, right? So, okay. So this is more like Apache Software Foundation. Okay, it's a non-profit organization. Yeah. Yes, Vipul, tell me. Vipul?
Yeah, actually, I had this question only about the security, that if an, you just explained it, that if XYZ comes and introduce some bugs into it, then what can be done? And my second question was,
yes, tell me.
My second question was, what is the benefit? For example, in your example, Microsoft is introducing a code in this open source environment, and then CloudEra is taking that code. So what is the benefit of working of several organization in a collaborative fashion? Is it monetary basis or?
Yeah, like everything at the end of the day, right? Like the companies do work for, it's a non-profit, right? They do work for profit only, right? So as I said, right, like the big data, it's a very huge system. Okay, so one company, they can't develop the entire thing. Okay, so that's the reason why they work in a collaborative fashion.
Okay.
So, yeah. That's what I said. Like, if I makes any change, Microsoft makes any changes, CloudEra can get it. If I make any changes, CloudEra can get it. If you make some changes, I can get them. So it's all about working in a collaborative fashion, right? Yeah. Yeah. You can unraise your hand. Yeah. Anyone else? The purpose of the Apache Software Foundation. Okay, there are a lot of projects under the Apache Software Foundation. Okay, there are few big data projects like Hadoop, Hive, Pig, HBase, and so on. I'll be talking about them later. And then, like, we do have some non-big data projects. Okay, the popular one is HTTPD. Okay, so it's a web server. Then we have Tomcat, it's a web server. Then Log4j, okay, it's a logging framework. Okay, then Castor, Xerxes, there are tons of them, okay. So, okay, big data and non-big data projects, okay. So, here, right, like what do we have? Like we have, let's say, the different Apache big data softwares, okay, like Hadoop, Hive, Pig, and so on. Okay, these companies, right, like what they do is, let's take the case of CloudEra. So they get the code from the Apache Software Foundation. Okay, as I said, it's open source, right? So they go here, get the code, and then they create their own Hadoop distribution. Okay, it's called CDH. Okay. So what do? They take the code from the Apache Software Foundation. They try to improve it. Okay, so make it fast and so on. Okay, they do provide better documentation. Okay, they fix some bugs. Okay, and then they create their own distribution called CDH. Okay, similarly, there's a company called Mapper. They take the code from the Apache Software Foundation, and then they create their own software called M3, M5, M7. Okay. Similarly, this is a company called Hortonworks. Okay. So they get the code and then they create their own distribution called HDP. Okay. And because of the open source nature, they call it free and open source. Open source software. They call it FOSS, okay? So anyone can take the software. I can start my own company called Praveen Inc. and then I can create my own Praveen distribution, okay? So no one can stop me, okay? So if I have the proper skill set, if I have the proper money, right, I can start my own company, okay? So like they take the code, improve the software, like they try to make it fast, they do provide better documentation, fix some bugs, okay? So these are the few ways they make money actually, okay? So they do provide commercial support, okay? So let's say we put it in production, okay? And if something goes bad, okay? So they, like we need some support, right? So the way we get IBM support from IBM for WebSphere, like Microsoft Windows support, right? Similarly, they do provide support, they do provide training, okay, and they do provide licenses. The way we get licenses for Windows from Microsoft, they do provide licenses. They do conduct workshops, training, so on and so on. So these are the few channels by which they make money out of it, okay? Any question on this slide? What's the significance of Cloudera and so on? Okay, let me take a few questions. Yeah, Chetan.
Hey Praveen, I have a question. Like you said, we can download any code from the Cloudera, right? Let's say, I want
Cloudera,
to download.
As I said, we can download the code from the Apache, not Cloudera. Yeah.
Right. So let's say Cloudera has a CDH. So any specific tool or something you recommend that we use, like you to get all the code at one go or something like that?
There's a tool called Git, actually. So you can use the Git tool to download the code.
Okay.
Git, it's a version control system tool. Okay, so all the code, right, like whenever we have code, like what do we use? We use a version control system, right? So they use Git. Okay, so you can use the Git tool to download the code in a single shot. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else? Okay. So, yeah, there's one more question. Let me take it here. Yeah, Praveen, tell me.
So the Cloudera, which provides the CDH version of big data softwares, mm-hmm. those are not an open source, right?
It depends upon the policy. Like if you take the case of Hortonworks, right? So they are 100% open source.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And what about Cloudera?
Cloudera, I can say they are 80% open source. Okay. So they, okay. or some they keep it closed source. They don't want to share with anyone. But like if you take the case of Mapper, they are mostly closed source or mostly proprietary actually. Okay, but Hortonworks or HDP is 100% open source. Yeah, so it depends upon the company to company, like depending upon what they decide, right? So, like Cloudera decided to go like mostly open source. HDP, like when they started the company, they decided to go with 100% open source and so on.
Okay. Right. Yeah. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah. So, like if you take the case of Microsoft, right? They're opening up lately. Okay, they were mostly proprietary, but nowadays, right, they are becoming more and more open source. Okay. So let's say, like, you want to use big data in production. Okay. So what will you go with? Like, you will go with something like Apache Big Data software, or you will go with the CDHM3? Which one? Just type it in the chat window. I want some rational also. Just don't simply say Apache software or Cloudera software. I'll be looking for some rational also. Which one will be using? Why? Anyone? Raise your hand. Like, I need a rational also. Yes, Satish, tell me. Hello. Okay, good. Okay, anyone else? Yeah, Praveen, tell me, which one will you use and why?
Yes, yeah, I'll prefer to go with Cloudera or Mapper because we may need a commercial support while we are having in production. Yeah.
Yes. So it depends actually. Like if you take the case of companies like Facebook, Yahoo, right, and so on. So like they do have enough expertise around big data tools and technologies. They have enough employees who know the in and out of the big data tools and technologies. Okay, similarly, like they won't need any commercial support. Okay, so they do have enough money to hire good people. So they will be going with Apache software. Okay, but let's say if you take the case of a bank, like Bank of America. Okay, their main focus is on banking. Okay, so similarly, one of you say United Health Group, right? So like healthcare. Okay, so their core expertise around healthcare, right? So they will be going with one of the commercial distribution like CDH, M3, M5, or HDP, and so on. Okay, so depending upon the company. Okay, I don't say Apache is bad or the commercial distributions are bad. Like depending upon the end user, like they go with one of the version. Any questions? When to go with what? Okay. So, like as you see, right? Like I'll be using less of slides, PowerPoints. I really hate them. Okay, I'll be using more of whiteboard. That's way I can express more actually. Okay. Any question? Like before I take a quick break, like what we'll do is like I'll start a timer. Like we'll be back in 15 minutes and then I'll be continuing my discussions around the same. Any questions before we take a break? Okay. Okay, let me start the timer. Like let's have a quick break then. Okay, thank you. Okay, I am back. Okay, so let's continue then. Okay, so as I said, right, like big data, there are two aspects. One is storing the data. Storing the data and then processing the data. So let me talk about how the data is stored. Like for storing the data, a software called HDFS is used. HDFS stands for Hadoop Distributed File System. So this is used for storing the data. Okay. So let me briefly talk about it. Okay. And then I'll talk about processing part later. Okay. So here, right, like what happens is, like when we want to store a petabyte of data, right? Okay, petabyte is a very huge amount. Okay, I won't be able to store a petabyte of data on a single machine. Okay. So what HDFS will do is, it will first split the data into small blocks. So it will literally split the file into small files. The small files are called blocks, okay, and the blocks are put on different machines. Okay, so here we do have B1 on machine 1, B2 on machine 2, and so on. Okay, so when we have, like here, right, let's say I have one machine with 3 hard drives. Each hard drive has 2 terabytes of capacity. So total, each machine has 6 terabytes of disk. So if I have 100 machines, I will be able to store 600 terabytes of data. If I have 1000 machines, I will be able to store 6000 terabytes of data, which is equal to 6 petabytes of data. So the more the machines I have, like I will be able to store more data. So here, right, like I won't be able to buy 1000 server grade machines, very high end machines. Okay. It will become very, very costly. So that's the reason why in the case of big data, we use something called commodity machines. So these commodity machines, right? So these are not as powerful as a server grade machine, okay, because the server grade machines are very, very costly. And these are not as dumb as a desktop machines, because the desktop machines fail in between. Okay. So they fall in between the commodity machines. Okay, so here, right, like when you go to the big data admin course, so they will talk about the sizing, what is the size of the machine, how many machines. It's called capacity planning and sizing. Okay, so here the course is mainly from a developer perspective, like I won't be talking about all the admin aspects. Okay. So here, right, like we'll be using a lot of commodity machines. It falls in between. Okay, so here, like you can have like thousands and thousands of commodity machines. Okay, so let's say I do have 10,000 commodity machines. Okay, when we have so many machines, there's a good probability that maybe like 2 or 3 machines will go down on a regular basis. Okay, so that's the reason why HDFS, what it will do is, first it will split the data into blocks, put the blocks on different machines, and then it will replicate the blocks. Okay, so let's say on this particular machine we have block 1 and it replicates the block on the same machine. Okay, so if the machine fails, then the block is lost. Okay, so that's the reason why HDFS is smart enough so that it will replicate the data on some other machine. So here, if you see, B1 is replicated here, B2 here, and so on. So let's say this particular machine goes down. So we have B1, B2, B3, B4. Okay. So none of the blocks are lost. None of the data is lost, actually. Okay. So this is how HDFS operates at a very, very high level. Okay. So by default, the replication factor is 3. Okay. So I can increase the replication factor, or I can decrease the replication factor. Okay. So when do I increase the replication factor? So let's say, like we do have very, very critical data. Okay, I can have the replication factor greater than 3, like 4, 5, 6, depending upon the criticality of the data. And for non-critical data, I can have the replication factor less than 3 also. And the default is 3. So how does Hadoop know whether the data is critical or not critical? Anyone? So that it can replicate the data appropriately. How does Hadoop know? How does Hadoop know the data is critical or not? Anyone? How does it know? Yeah, Basudev, tell me. You are on mute. Hello?
Yeah. You have to define it, like, you know, in the configuration, if the data that you are processing is critical, that you can define the replication factor more than 3,
okay.
Or not critical, you can define less than 3 in the yes. configuration file. That question.
Yes. So Hadoop doesn't know whether the data is critical or not. So we have to tell Hadoop, okay, so this data has to be replicated 5 times, this data has to be replicated 1 time, and so on. Okay, because for Hadoop or HDFS, data is data, it's all about zeros and ones, right? It can't figure out what is critical and what is non-critical. So we have to specify the replication factor, okay? So later on, when we talk about HDFS in detail, like I'll be showing you how to put the data, how to get the data back, how to specify the replication factor, and so on, okay? By default, the replication factor is 3. So here, when the file is being split into blocks, each block is of 64 MB. So let's say we have a file of 200 MB. So it will be split up into 4 blocks, 64, 64, 64, 64, and last 8 MB, because the total should sum up to 200 MB. Okay. Usually the last block is less than 64 MB because the sum should be less than, sorry, the sum should be 200 MB, right? So, okay. So here, right, like when we, 1 second. Yeah. Okay, so there are a lot of failure scenarios here, like when we have a petabyte of data, when we have thousands of machines, right? So there can be a lot of problems. So one of the problem is this machine might go down. Okay, so if you see, I have only one copy of B1 and one copy of B4. Okay, Hadoop will notice this, and then it will make another copy of B1. Okay, and similarly, it will make another copy of B4. Okay. Similarly, what can happen is once in a while, right, the files in our machines can get corrupted, right? Similarly, a block can get also corrupted. So HDFS will automatically notice this, and then it will copy a healthy block from some other machine to this particular machine. Okay. Similarly, let's say this machine has 3 hard drives. Okay, so one of the hard drive crashes. So Hadoop will notice this, and then it will take a corrective action. Okay. So Hadoop, right, like it will, or HDFS, like it will try to address the different failure scenarios. Okay, so we don't need to worry about it. Okay, so it will address most of the failure scenarios. Okay, like a block getting corrupted, machine going down, hard disk crashing, it will take some corrective action automatically. Okay. So what we need to do is, like, we need to say, okay, HDFS, I do have this petabyte of data, go ahead and store it. Okay. So it will automatically split the file into blocks, put the blocks on different machines, replicate them, okay, based upon the replication factor we specify. And then automatically it will address the different failure scenarios. Okay. So this HDFS, right, like it is based on Google's paper called Google File System. It's GFS paper. Okay. So when I say a paper, right, it's all about theory. Okay. So Google, right, very regularly releases papers. Okay. So it doesn't release the cutting edge, but like maybe -1, -2, right? Like it will release the previous papers. Okay, so someone with a niche, they will read the paper and then they implemented HDFS. So Google, right, like it has a very unique requirement actually. Okay, so they do have a lot of services like search, ad service, Picasa, Gmail, right? They do, right? They, like AdWords, they do have a lot of services. So they need to store a lot of data and they need to process a lot of data. Okay, so that's the reason why they do continuously do a lot of innovation, and then once in a while they release the papers. Okay, so if you want to see what are all the current papers released, so you can go to simply research.google.com. Okay, so there are a lot of big data papers, non-big data papers, and so on. So if you want to know what is the next big thing around big data, you can go here and read the papers. Okay, but the papers are like very, very, very high level. Okay, so it's difficult to get a what should I say, like understanding of those papers. Okay, so at least you can go through the paper and then figure out what it is all about. Okay, but like going through each of this paper in detail, right, it's very, very tough actually. Okay, so I'm sending you this paper, this link. Okay, research.google.com. So we'll be looking at HDFS in detail later, next week. Okay, so I'll show you how to start HDFS, how to stop it, right, how to put some data in HDFS, how to get some data, right, how it addresses the different failure scenarios and all those things. So next week we'll talk in detail. Yeah. Any question around HDFS? This is a brief about how HDFS stores the data. Yeah, Ashwati, tell me. You have to answer.
Praveen, why do we use HDFS? Why can't we go with a RAID system?
RAID system, right? Like it uses a special type of hardware, actually. Okay. So
yeah,
the hardware. Like here, right? Like here, it makes more of a cost sense actually. Okay, so here we use a commodity, so hardware. Commodity hardware, it's cheaper, and like we use open source software. So it makes sense more from a cost perspective instead of using a RAID system to go for something like HDFS. Yeah.
Okay, and what about storage access networks?
I am not that familiar with the SAN, NAS, RAID, but I don't like, I haven't worked much on them, but like this is the current trend. Yeah, I won't be able to compare because I don't know much about the SAN actually.
So will you be able to tell me at a later on point, at a later on time, that why mainly we go for HDFS other than the financial aspect? Is there any technical reason that we opt for HDFS and not for RAID?
Let me look at it, but as I said, right, like first I need to get familiar with what RAID is, what SAN is, and so on, right? So then I can talk about like the comparisons, right? So let me see, depending upon my time, either, right? But like
okay, it will be very helpful. It will be very helpful if you will able to answer it.
But as I said,
because right, I have.
Tell me, yeah. Yes, tell me.
Like it will be very helpful. I'll also like I have read somewhere all these things, but I was not able to get the exact difference. I got more confused, so that's why I asked you.
Okay, let me see. But as I said, like first I need to get familiar with what RAID is, what SAN. Okay, it's a bit of a small project, but I noted it down. Let me see how I can justify it. Okay, but
okay, only like thank you.
Yeah. It will be something like an immediate thing, but let me see. Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Yeah. You can unraise your hand. Yeah. Yeah, Chetan, tell me.
Yeah, Praveen, let's say in a commodity machine, is it something that SDFS we need to configure, or how the SDFS, the commodity machine will know?
Machine is a machine, right? With the machine, right, like we get a CPU, hard disk, RAM, right? Like we won't get anything on it. So we need to install HDFS and the different softwares, right?
Okay. So it's kind of a machine only, right? It's a commodity machine.
Commodity machine, that's what it is. Any machine will have CPU, RAM, hard disk, right?
Okay.
We need to install what we want to.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah. Yes, Roger.
Yeah, Praveen. Once, I mean, can you just show me the previous slide once?
Which slide? I mean the slide, the HDFS slide.
Yes.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, here you said the once the machine is failed, I mean some machine crashes, it makes a copy, the other machines make the copy of that particular blocks like B1 or B4, right? So once the machine is up and running, are those blocks again rolled back or are they, will they stay in the same machines?
It will be deleted actually, so that we can use that space for something else, right? It will be automatically deleted. Yeah.
Deleted, okay. Yeah.
So at any point of time, right, so like the blocks are properly replicated, okay, so then those are underly replicated, okay, then it can go to overly replicated state, okay, so at any point of time it will try to maintain the properly replicated state, okay, so it will go from under replicated, over replicated to the, so it will shuffle between the over replicated and under replicated, it will try to maintain the properly replicated state.
Okay, yeah, that's great. Yeah.
Otherwise, it's an unnecessary waste of the space, right? So, yeah. Anyone else? As I said, right, like once you are done, you can unraise your hand, Raja. So, I don't need to tell to each and everyone, right? So, in the class, we don't keep our hand raised for the entire 3 hours, right? Yeah, Praveen, tell me.
Yeah, so going forward with this question, like if a machine is available, then we delete the blocks which we copy to someone else machine, right? So is this decided based on the replication factor or something else? Is it decision factor on that?
Yeah, it's decided by the replication factor. At any point of time, it will maintain the proper replication factor. Whatever we specify, right, it will maintain the proper replication factor.
Yeah, thanks.
Anything else? Like as I said, right, like we'll be spending close to 3 hours around HDFS. We'll be talking about it in a bit more detail. But just I wanted to give a brief idea about what HDFS is all about. Okay. So like once we store the data, right, the next step is to process the data. Okay. So here, like we do have the blocks on different machines. So why can't we process the blocks on different machines? Okay, so here I have P1 processing B1, P2, B2, and so on. Okay, so here we are doing some distributed processing. Okay, so here again, let's say we do have thousands of machines. So when we have thousands of machines, right, so again we do have a couple of problems. Okay, so P1 might crash, so no one is processing block one. Okay, so I can, Hadoop will automatically, or the big data framework will automatically start another process to process B1. Similarly, this machine might crash. No one is processing B2. It will start another process on some other machine, okay, to process the B2. Okay, similarly, this might be running slow. Okay, so it took almost 15 minutes and then the processing didn't complete. Okay, so it will start another process automatically to process the block. Okay. So the way when we store the data, there are some failure scenarios. Similarly, when we process the data also, there are different failure scenarios. Okay, the big data framework will automatically take care of the different failure scenarios. So we don't need to worry about, okay, what happens if a process crashes, if a machine crashes, okay, so if something is running slow. All these things are taken care automatically by the underlying software. So what I need to do is, like, how do I process this block? How to process? Okay, so that's the only thing I need to worry about, because the different failure scenarios and so on are taken care by the underlying software. Okay, how do I calculate the average marks? How do I convert a color image to a black and white? How do I compress a video? How do I extract a text from a image? Okay, how do I do the facial recognition? Okay, so that's what I need to worry about. Okay. All the different failure scenarios are automatically addressed actually. Yeah. How to process, that's what we need to focus on. Any question? Okay. So generally what I do is, like when I try to talk about a new thing, right, I try to compare wherever possible, right, to something which we already know. Okay. So let's say let's try to compare with databases. Okay, so here when we talk about databases, right, like we do have hierarchical databases, then relational databases, in between we had object oriented databases, and then NoSQL databases. Okay. And then for the hierarchical database we have IMS, for the relational database we have MySQL, for the object oriented some XYZ. Similarly for NoSQL databases we have HBase, Cassandra, and so on. Okay, so these are the different models. Okay, these are the different models. Models, it's all about theory, right? So relational model, database model, how can I use it? Okay, it's a theory, it's a concept, right? And these are the implementations. Okay. So why do people come up with new models, new implementations? Anyone? Why are we not happy with the hierarchical model? Why are we not happy with the RDBMS model? Why do they come up with new model? Currently NoSQL model is the current trend. Tomorrow it might be something else. Why do they come up with new models? Okay. Requirement changes, one of you say, right? The other thing is, like, as we use something more and more, right, like we tend to find the limitations of it actually. Okay. To address the limitations of the previous model, they come up with new models. Okay. So similarly, when we process the data in a distributed fashion, there are different models. So where do we store the data? We store the data in HDFS, and there are different models. MapReduce is a model. RDD stands for Resilient Distributed Dataset. Okay, I'll be talking about it later. MPI, Message Passing Interface. Bulk synchronous parallel graph model. Okay, so depending upon, as you say, one of you say, depending upon the requirement, like we need to go with one of the model. Okay, it's all about theory. The models are theory. Okay, so then we have the implementations. For MapReduce model, we have Hadoop, RDD, Spark, MPI, OpenMPI, and so on. Okay, so it's not like there are some pros and cons about each model and implementation. Okay, so first we need to understand what our requirement is, and then we can choose the appropriate model. Okay, so currently these are the popular models. Okay, so one of you said, like, you work on Neo4j, right? So it's somewhat related to the graph model. Okay, so I'll be talking about the Hadoop MapReduce model, and I'll be talking about the Spark RDD model also. Yeah, mainly around the Hadoop MapReduce model, briefly about the Spark RDD model. Like, any question on this slide? At the bottom, I do have the models, and on top of it, I do have the implementations. Even? Okay. So let's look at what is Hadoop. Hadoop is a framework or a software used for storing the data. For storing the data, it uses HDFS. We talked about HDFS. And for analysis of the data, it uses MapReduce. So these are the two components of Hadoop. Okay. So it will address many of the challenges with distributed processing and storage, right? We talked about it, a machine going down, a hard disk crashing, a process getting crashed. Okay, it uses HDFS and MapReduce. It's a free software. We talked about the ASF, and commercial support is available from Cloudera, Hortonworks, Amazon, and so on. And the deployments are in the range of thousands of machines. If you take the case of a Oracle database server, like maximum you can have like 8-9 in a cluster. But if you see, there are thousands of machines in a big data cluster. So this is a quick brief about what Hadoop is. Anything? Any question? Okay. So we got introductions, like I talked about what is big data use cases, what is MapReduce. Okay, so let me talk about the prerequisites. To get started with big data, right, like we need to know the basics of Linux. Okay, so I will be covering the basics of Linux. Like I've been using Linux for close to 10 years. Okay, so I'm very comfortable with it. Okay, so like this, I can talk about Linux for hours and hours together, but I will be talking just what is enough to get started with big data. Okay, and then you need to be familiar with the core Java, because when we write MapReduce programs, okay, so here as I said, right, like I'll be talking about Hadoop, MapReduce, right? So like we'll be writing programs in Java. Okay, so here we need to know Java. And the third is SQL. Okay, so these are the three prerequisites. You go through them in the same order. Okay, so let's say you're not comfortable with all three of them, then you can start with Linux, then Java, then SQL. Okay, if you are, this is the way in which we would be using the different softwares. Okay, so I do expect you guys to be familiar with this, but I would be covering the basics of Linux sometime tomorrow. Okay, but this is the order. Okay. One reason, as I said, right, like we need to know Java because we'll be using MapReduce program. What's the other reason, anyone? What's the other reason to know Java? If you see, 99% of the big data softwares are developed in Java. Big data softwares developed in Java. Okay. And it's open source. Okay. So most of the times, right, like you will see that the documentation is very poor or the documentation is not there. So then what we have to do is like we have to go through the code and then figure out why something fails, is failing, or why something is not working as expected. Okay, so like you need to go through this particular URL and then figure it out. The one, 1 second. Okay, so here we can get the code and then see why it is not behaving as expected, okay, or why something is failing. Okay, most of the cases, the documentation is really bad. Like it's not, I say, for everything, but like for some of the software, right? Like, but most of the software, it's bad. But some of the software, it's really good, actually. Okay, so it's all free software, right? So that I can't demand, okay, and say, okay, why there's no good documentation? Okay, if you are really interested, it's all open source, right? So you can also provide some good documentation for Hadoop and so on. Anyone with an interest can contribute for it. Okay, and SQL, why? Like we'll be using with a software called Hive. Okay, so maybe second week, third week, we'll be looking at Hive also. Okay. Any question? These are the prerequisites. Okay. So how many of you know what a virtual machine is? Simply raise your hand. VM, virtual machine. I'll be using the word VM a lot. How many of you are familiar with it? Okay. 1, 2, maybe, okay, like 50% of you. So let me talk about VM or virtualization. Okay, so here, like let's say this is our laptop, okay, some hardware, laptop, desktop or whatever. So here we have Windows or Linux or Mac. Okay. So here, right, like we can run one operating system on another operating system by using virtualization. So to use virtualization, we need a software. Like here I will be using a software called Oracle VirtualBox. So it's a free software, as the name says, from Oracle. So it will help us to run one operating system on another operating system. Okay, so here, like we will be running Ubuntu. Okay, on top of Ubuntu, like we do have Hadoop, Hive, Pig, HBase, Cassandra, and the different softwares already installed and configured for you. Okay, so what we have done is we have packaged this. Okay, and then it's a very big file. That's the reason why we have split it, and then we have put it in Dropbox. Because it's already installed, configured for you, right? You don't need to worry about, okay, how do I install Ubuntu? How do I install the different big data softwares? How do I configure them? It's already done for you, okay? So this will help you to be very productive. Okay. So for this to run, right, like you need a machine with 3 to 4 GB RAM. And like around 15 GB of hard disk. And a i3 processor would be good enough, but like if you have more RAM, more a better CPU, right? Like it runs very smoothly actually. Okay, but at least these are the minimum requirements, I would say. Okay. Let me show you the VM. Like here, this is called the host operating system, and this is called the guest operating system. Okay. So we can run multiple guest operating systems, but if you have a very powerful machine, so I can run 5, 10, and so on. Okay. So let me show you the VM which like we have created. Okay. Start VirtualBox. So how to configure and all those things, right? It has been discussed yesterday. Okay. So like if you're not, if you have not attended it, like you can go through the recording. Okay. So I can configure multiple VMs. So I'll select the appropriate VM and then click on start. Okay, so depending upon the configuration of your machine, it will take a minute or a couple of minutes. Okay. One second, let it start. Yeah. So here, if you see, we are running Ubuntu on top of Windows. Okay. And like I'll be walking through Ubuntu tomorrow, but like this is called not. These are the quick launchers. Okay, the way we have quick launchers at the bottom. These are the quick launchers, and this is called Nautilus. Nautilus is very similar to Windows Explorer. We can browse the files and folders. Okay, so here I have created a folder called installations. And then under the installations, you can see the different softwares which have been installed and configured already. Okay. So I'll be talking about it tomorrow, but like the sooner you configure the VM, the sooner you can get familiar with Linux, and then the sooner you can practice the different softwares. Okay, so once in a while, right, like I do get participants who install the VM at the very last session, okay, but the sooner you do it, the sooner the better it is. Okay. So this is one thing we do provide as part of the training. So there's no expiry time. You can use it as long as you want to. Okay, it's all open source and free software, right? The other thing is like you don't need to be connected to the internet also. You can use it offline also. The other thing which we do provide is the Collabora cluster. Okay, so we do have our own data center. Okay. So we do have a cluster of machines on which we have installed the big data softwares. Okay. It's called DC or a data center in which we have a bunch of machines. Okay. So let's say here is your laptop. Okay, and you can access the machines from your laptop, and then you can run the different programs, MapReduce programs, Spark programs, and so on. So for this VM, like there's no limitation. You can use it as long as you want to. And here I'm using the Apache software. Okay, I downloaded from the Apache and then I configured it. But when we created the cluster, okay, so we do have the Cloudera software on this particular machine. So the reason why we did this is that you can, so that you can get a feel about both of them. Here we are using the Cloudera software. Okay. And then like we'll be giving access for 2 years for this particular cluster. Okay. From the day you started the course, like 2 years from then on. Okay. Any question on these two? 1 second. Yeah, Vipul. Vipul?
Hi, my question. Yeah, my question is about you just used the word cluster. So, could you please explain a little bit more about it?
A cluster is a group of logical machines, nothing more than that. Yeah.
But no, I mean, I know that dictionary meaning. In
okay.
In terms of Hadoop, because in my company, cluster we are working on...
A cluster is a cluster, man. There's nothing like a Hadoop cluster, big data cluster, COBOL cluster. A cluster is a group of machines, nothing more than that, actually. It's a group of machines, yeah. That's it, nothing more than that, yeah. It's a Hadoop cluster means it's a group of machines on which Hadoop is installed. If I say Oracle cluster, it's a group of machines on which Oracle is installed. It's not a dictionary meaning, that's the actual meaning. It's a group of machines, actually, logical group of machines, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah, Santosh, tell me. You're on mute. Hello. Yes.
Sir, I would like to ask, you said that you are providing virtual machine with installed Hadoop.
Yes.
Could you teach how we will install?
No, actually, right, like the course, right, like it's Hadoop developer course. Okay, so 80% of the time, right, like we do focus on the developer aspect. Okay, so we will talk about how to use Hadoop, how to use Pig and so on. So only maybe like 10 to 15, let me complete it, okay, 1 second. Okay, so like 20% of the time, like we'll be focusing on the admin side, okay. So this is more of a developer course, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So like if you are really interested in the admin aspects, like how do I install, how do I configure, fine tune, security. So we do have a separate course, okay, admin course. There they will be talking about how do I install Hadoop, Hive, Pig and so on. Okay, it's mainly of a developer course. Yeah, tell me.
No, I mean to say that the software you are providing is for virtual machine. If I need to install on my Ubuntu OS installed in my system.
So then, like if you go to the admin course, like as I said, like they will talk about how to install a piece of software, how to configure it, how to fine tune it, how to queue permissions, how to upgrade it, patch it. So that's the main focus of the admin course. Yeah. Tell me.
Okay. Here you nothing tell about how no basic or no steps.
What did I say? Like here I said it, like I'll be focusing 20% on the admin, 80% on the developer, right? So here I'll be talking a little bit, but my main focus won't be admin. My main focus will be developer.
Yeah. The installation part is in admin.
Where does it fall? Like, where? What do you think?
No, I just want to know.
I'm asking you, like installation, does it fall under the developer role or the admin role? Admin, right? If you take any company, right, like there will be like a Oracle admin, maybe mainframe admin, DB2 admin, right? So they will be the one like who will be installing the different softwares, patching them, security, access, upgrading them. Yeah, tell me.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's fine.
So here, like, we'll be mainly focusing on, like, how do I use Hadoop, how do I use Pig, and so on, okay? We'll be looking at a few aspects, but that's not the main focus, yeah. Yeah, Vasudev, tell me.
Yeah, I have a quick question. You're talking about a cluster that you'll be provided. So, and you also talk about the commodity machine earlier. So are those cluster consists of all the commodity machines?
Yes, sort of.
Okay, yep. And when you are dealing like my laptop,
it doesn't matter actually, like whether it's a commodity machine or a high-end machine, like
okay.
Basically, like you'll be accessing the machines and then running some programs, right? How does it matter?
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Yeah. Tell me.
Yeah, another quick question. I'll be running the in my laptop and I'll be connected to the cluster. So will this be my laptop will be acting as a master and the cluster will be acting as a slave kind of thing?
There's nothing like a master slave here, like everything will be running in the cluster itself.
Okay.
So here you will be using a lightweight software called PuTTY to access a remote machine and everything will be running on the machine. Okay, there's nothing like a master slave, like the PuTTY is used to connect to a remote machine. That's the only thing we would be.
Okay.
everything will be running remotely in the Collabora data center. One second. Yeah, Pankaj. Hello.
Hey, hi, Praveen. Is there an instruction how to configure VirtualBox on my machine? I mean, so to connect to do it.
Yeah, that's what. Like yesterday, like there was a orientation session yesterday, like where they talked about how to install VirtualBox, how to configure the VM. I think there was a session. Did you attend it yesterday?
No, I was busy actually, so I did not attend.
Okay, no problem. Okay, so go through it. If you have any questions, then. Ask the backend team, they will be helping you.
Okay, is there any email which is I can shoot the email the backend team you said?
No, send a mail to Bhavik. Hey, Bhavik, can you email them the, you can email them and then, okay, they are the first point of contact, like if they are not able to get it through, like then they will escalate it to me or they will take my help and then get it done. But they are the first level of contact. Okay? So that's the protocol we use. Yeah.
Okay, so, thank you.
So it's a general suggestion. Like if you, Pankaj, you can unraise your hand. Okay. So if you miss any session, right, like I would very much recommend to go through the session, right? Otherwise, there will be questions like this only. Okay. The topics, right, like they're very much interrelated. Okay, so if you miss for some reason which you can't avoid, definitely go through the recordings and then try to attend the next session. Okay. Yes, Vipul. Hello.
Hi, Praveen. Sorry to ask again, but when you say the 2 years for the Collabora cluster, is that means that the lifespan of this cluster, the group of machine, is actually 2 years? I just want to confirm this.
The cluster will be running forever. But like you would be given access to 2 years. Okay, so basically here, right, what we do is like we will be creating a login for you. Okay, so that you can access the machine. After 2 years, your login will be disabled.
Okay, that I understand. Okay, I got it. Thanks.
Yeah. So after 2 years, like you won't be able to access the cluster and use it. Starting from the course start date, 2 years you will be given access. Anything else? Okay. So let me talk about the NoSQL databases. So the way we do have databases, right? Like here also, like relational database and so on. Like here in the case of big data, we do have NoSQL. Okay, so these are called big data databases. Okay, so there are more than 125 plus NoSQL databases. Okay, so one of you work on NEO, right? NEO is a NoSQL database. Okay, so these 125 plus NoSQL databases have been categorized into key value databases, columnar databases, document databases, and graph databases. Okay, these are the categorizations. For the key value, we have Dynamo. Dynamo, React, Acumulo. Okay, for the columnar, we have HBase, Cassandra. For the document, we have Mongo, M-O-N-G-O, like mango, couch. Okay. And for graph, we have Neo, for J, and Flock. Okay, so one of you had been working on this particular graph database. Okay. So depending upon the requirement, right, like first we have to figure out whether we want to go with something like a relational database or NoSQL. If I want to go with NoSQL, then I will decide whether I want to go with a key value columnar. Let's say we decide to go with the columnar, then we have a choice of HBase and Cassandra and so on. Okay, so we have to first understand what our requirements are and then choose and pick the appropriate NoSQL database. Okay, so during the course, like we'll be having a quick demo of Cassandra, Mongo, Neo, okay, but we'll be looking at HBase in detail. HBase is one of the popular databases. Okay, later on I'll show you some salary reports where they say HBase is popular one. Okay, I'll be talking about HBase in detail. So first I'll talk about what columnar databases are, how they are able to scale much better than relational databases, and then I'll talk about HBase. Okay, so this is the pattern I follow. Like when I talk about HBase, MapReduce, PigHive. So first I'll be talking about the use case, when to use it, and then I'll be talking about the architecture, and then I'll be talking about how to interact or what are the different interfaces. Okay, and finally I'll be talking about some of the advanced features. So this is the pattern I follow for any of the softwares. Okay. Any question on this slide? Okay. I talked about the VM, I talked about the cluster, we talked about use cases. Okay. So let me talk about the ecosystem. So here, right, like if you closely follow the big data space, right, like every month some new big data software is being released. Okay, so some of them they do become popular as more and more users use. Okay, some of them there's not much traction, right? So but Hadoop, right, like it acts like a kernel. Okay, so this is the heart of most of the big data softwares. Okay, like most of the softwares sit on top of Hadoop. Okay, so this is software called Scoop. So let's say we do have some data in a relational database and then we want to move it to HDFS. Okay, so we can use Scoop. Scoop stands for SQL to Hadoop. Scoop. Okay, it works the other way also. RDBMS, HDFS to RDBMS. Okay, so this has got Mahout. This is Mahout. So it has got many machine learning algorithms like classification, clustering, recommendations, regressions, and so on. Okay, and we talked about HBase, it's a NoSQL database. So this is Flume. Flume, if you want to pull the data from Facebook, Twitter, and so on, then I can use the Flume. Okay, and it's called Zookeeper. It's a bit too early. Later on, I will be talking about the significance of Zookeeper. And this is Pig. Okay, Pig is used for processing of the data. Hive is used for processing of the data. And this is called Giraffe for graph processing. Okay. So this is an R language. Okay. So why do we use R? Anyone? It has got a lot of statistical libraries actually. The reason why a language is popular is because of the libraries around it. Okay. So here R has got a lot of libraries. It has got more than 5,000 libraries around statistical processing. So people tend to use R a lot actually. Okay. So like later on I'll be talking about few of the softwares. Like we'll be looking at some of them. Okay. And these are the few of the companies which are providing the commercial support around big data. Okay. There are a lot of companies, some in the stealth mode, some in the open mode and so on. Okay, because of the open source nature, right? Anyone can provide the commercial support. Okay. And these are a few of the companies which are using the big data. So how do you think Facebook uses big data? Anyone? Facebook. How do they use the big data? For what? So they use it for fraud detection, they use it for recommendation, they use it for photo tagging. So as soon as I upload a picture to Facebook, right, like it will identify the persons in that particular picture, right? Like it will say, okay, this is Praveen, this is X, this is Y. Okay. Yeah, like one of you say, does Oracle have a solution around big data? Yes. Okay, so not if, like everyone wants to have a pie in the big data space. Okay, so almost everyone is jumping into the big data space. They do, they have their own offerings, okay? So it has been so vast, so I don't follow all of them, okay? So I do follow a few of them, okay? So Oracle also has definitely a solution. They do have some customized hardware. They call it appliances, okay? So like hardware fine-tuned with the software and so on, okay? These are called appliances, yeah, they do have. So this is the course content. Okay, so let me, okay. So first I'll be talking about tomorrow, right? Like I'll be talking about introduction to Linux. We already talked about what is big data. So next week I'll be talking about HDFS in detail. So once we are done with HDFS, I'll be talking about the theoretical concepts around MapReduce. Okay, so before we write program in Java, right? Like we need to know what object orientation is, inheritance, classes, objects, attributes, and so on, right? So methods. So here also we need to know what MapReduce is. We need to think in a MapReduce way. So I'll be talking about the theoretical concepts, then we'll look at MapReduce in practice. Okay, so we'll see how to write a MapReduce program, debug it, optimize it, deploy it. Right? For each of these, right, there are multiple ways of them. Okay, so we'll look into MapReduce. Then we'll look at Pig and Hive. Pig and Hive are other ways of processing the data. So once we are done with it, then we look at NoSQL database. Again, I'll start with the theoretical aspect. Then we'll look at the HBase in detail, the architecture, interface, and so on. Okay. And here I'll be talking about the ecosystem. Okay. So like these, right? Like HDFS, I'll be talking close to 3 hours. MapReduce around 5 to 6 hours. Pig and Hive close to 6 hours, HBase around 5 to 6 hours and so on. But when I talk about this ecosystem, I'll be talking about what is the use case and a simple demo. Okay, I won't be talking about in detail. Okay, so given a particular requirement, you will know whether you have to use Scoop or Impala or Neo or what. Okay, so that's the level of understanding I want to, but it's not like I want to make an expert of each one of you in these components, okay? So given a particular requirement, you should be in a state to know that Scoop is suitable for that particular requirement, then Uzi, okay? That's what I want to. Okay, so once we are done with this, I'll be talking about the Hadoop admin. Okay, so I'll show you, like I can't show you, but like I'll be talking about how I created the VM. I'll be talking about it. I'll be giving some documentation around it. So then we'll be talking about what a cloud is. Okay. Then we'll be setting up a small CDH cluster on the Amazon cloud. The Amazon cloud is called AWS. Okay. So like we'll be setting up a small cluster. This I'll be showing you in practice. Okay. I will be providing some documentation on the VM creation steps. Okay, because like it will take like a couple of hours actually. It will take 6-7 hours because I need to install the OS, install the different softwares, configure them, and so on. Right? It will take some time. Okay, so I'll be giving some guidelines, some documentation. I'll be talking about it, but how to set up the cluster, I'll be showing you in practice. Okay, then we'll be doing some projects. So once the projects are done, there will be a certification actually. Okay, and after each of these, right? Like after HDFS, there will be an assignment. So after MapReduce, there will be an assignment. Okay, so already all the assignments, right, like they have been uploaded to LMS. Okay, I have closed the window, but all of them have been uploaded to LMS. Okay, so once a particular topic is done, you can download the assignment and then you can start working on it. Okay. So this is the course content at a very, very high level. Okay. So tomorrow, right, like I'll be, this is the plan. Tomorrow I'll be talking about the course content I talked about today. So tomorrow I'll be talking about the career paths. Okay, so like if you take the case of Oracle database, right, like you can go apply or you can opt for a developer role or you can opt for a Oracle database admin role, right? So here also there are different career paths. So depending upon your interest, depending upon your experience, you can like plan for a particular career path. So once this is done, like I'll be talking about the basics of Linux. But depending upon the time, we'll be getting started with HDFS. That's the plan for tomorrow. Okay. So these are the few things which we talked in today. So we talked about high level. Starting from tomorrow onwards, we'll talk about in detail. Okay. So, yeah. Any questions, feel free to ask me. Yeah, Chetan, tell me.
Hey, Praveen. For any offline technical questions, do we need to first contact Bhavik or we can shoot the mail directly to you?
Yeah, like just send him an email and he will try to figure it out. If he is not able to, then he will immediately get it done and with me and then he will get back to you. Okay, so that's the protocol we do follow. Most of them, he would be able to help you. If not, he will get back to me. Yes, Satish, tell me.
For certification, what certification is exactly is that actually? Is it with Cloudera certification or like with respect to any distribution or is it like a common certification? How it goes?
I don't get you. What do you mean by common certification?
No. Certification, like you're recommending any specific certification or is it like
This course, right, like it's developer course, right, like Hortonworks has a developer certification, similarly Cloudera has a developer certification, okay?
Yeah.
Like they have admin certification also, but like we don't cover the admin aspects in detail, right? So I would suggest to go through the developer certification. First, I would recommend the Hortonworks developer, then the Cloudera developer, because they Cloudera developer certification, they are in the middle of revamping the certification. So Hortonworks certification is what I would recommend. That's a bit easy also. That's what I would recommend. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure, yeah. One of you is asking what is the 1022 fee? Like you can go to this site, like I don't recall, but it is close to $200 for the Hortonworks and close to $300 for the way some of you might have taken the GRE token, right? Similarly, you need to book a slot and then go to the particular certification center and then take the certificate. You'll get the results back immediately. And then they will award you with the certificate like in a 2-3 weeks time. That's the plan. Bhavik, I sent you the contact details. So like, but try to be a bit reasonable with him. Okay, so many times, right, like he gets the question that Scoop is not working, Flume is not working. Okay, so there are 101 reasons why something is not working, okay, or why something works. So you have to be a bit clear when you say something is not working. You have to tell him what you are trying to do. Okay, and then you have to also tell him like what is the message you are getting back. Okay, like an exception message or an error message. Then he will be able to help you. So very often I also do get the question, what is Scoop? Okay, I don't tend to respond back because they should put a minimal effort to understand what Scoop is, right? So, okay. But try to be a bit reasonable with him. Like he is also a bit busy actually, okay? Try to, the more clear you are on a particular question, the more quickly you'll be getting it, okay? Yeah, Praveen.
Yeah, my question is like what the assignments you talked about, right? Are those assignments we do have to do it on a VMs or how do
we do it? Either way you can, but like I say, to get started with, try with the VM. So later on you can try it in the cluster also.
Right. And my second question is on certification data. I have been told that there will be a Cloudera certification as well after finishing the course. So
yeah, that's what I say here. Yeah, that's what I said. If you, where am I? We talked about the course content somewhere, right?
So right,
here,
yeah, and you last mentioned certification.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, that's what here I said, right? Like this is certification after the project, right? So there will be a certification also.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
Yeah, sure, yeah. Anyone else? Yeah, Bridge, tell me. Bridge?
Hi. I want to know in terms of technology stack, which is more popular, like in the Cloudera or Horton, and like, you know, which version are we going to be like working on?
Both are popular. like as time goes on, right, like I'll be talking about the differences also. Okay. I'll be talking about the differences, like I'll be talking about how to use them and so on. Okay? So I'll be talking as time goes on, I'll be, okay.
No, my question was more around like, you know, once we finish the course, which one we should we concentrate on to get to be like, you know, more marketable?
More marketable, both are equal actually. If you say Horton Work, Cloudera, both, that's what, right? Like, it's a bit too early, but like both are same actually. Like if you, one second, let's say I do write a MapReduce program. The same MapReduce program will run on the Apache, and it will run on the CDH software also, and it will run on the HDP software also. So you don't need to learn a new set of API or a new set of programming paradigm. From a developer perspective, there is very less difference between Apache, Hadoop, and it, okay? Similarly, if you write a PIG program or a Hive program, it's all the same, okay? But from an admin perspective, how do I install Apache, how do I install CDH, HDP, it's a bit different. From a developer perspective, I don't see much difference actually.
No, in terms of industry usage, is it like, you know, based on which, like, you know, on the what do you call domain, or like a financial Horton is more like prevalent?
That's what I said, right? Like from a developer perspective, there's no difference. Like when I write a MapReduce program, it doesn't matter whether I run it on Apache, whether I run it on, it doesn't matter actually. For a developer, it doesn't make any difference actually. Whatever it is, right, whether okay. It's a Cloudera software or a HTTP, the same MapReduce program, the same PIG, the same Hive program, it will run on the different softwares. So how does it matter what we are working on? It doesn't matter actually. Okay. So, but if you say out of HDP, CDH, which is popular, both are having good traction actually. Yeah. Same MapReduce program. Later on, we'll say how to run it on Apache, how to run it on CDH. It's the same commands, it's the same program that we will be running. Because this is how it runs, right? Like, let's say we start with SQL, right? Like, if you strictly follow the SQL standards, it doesn't matter whether I run it on MySQL or Oracle Database or SQL Server, right? Okay, if we strictly follow the standards here also, if you strictly follow the MR, it doesn't matter where we are running it. Yeah. Okay. Anything else? Okay. So let's meet tomorrow, guys. As I said, like I'll be exactly starting at 7 o'clock. One student, two students, like participants. Like here today, I've seen few of you have been joining around 7:20. Okay. So if you ask me, okay, can you repeat it again? My answer is no. So I log in 6:45, 15 minutes ahead. Like I would recommend everyone to join it. Okay, I won't be repeating the topic. If you are really interested, you can watch the videos. Like if I repeat it for each and everyone, right? Like we won't be able to make much progress. Okay, so try to be on time. Okay, so that you don't miss anything then. Okay, yeah. Thanks a lot, guys. Then. Okay, have a nice weekend. Bye.